Thank you for inviting me. I'm delighted to be here and delighted to have an old friend in the audience. What I want to do today is, I'm going to go to the intro. The outline, I wanted to start with an introduction and then a history of the context of rural development debates, three major periods, and then a history in particular the spread of mechanisation in rural areas of South Asia to give it some substance and some observations on that, and then think about what's new in the debates and what's old, and some concluding remarks and acknowledgements, and a bit of background materials, articles on the history of debates, which I've done with Shelley Feldman and Frank Ellis and others over the years. And I realise it goes back to the early 80s. So that's the outline. My background is one of being an economist. Well, started in agriculture from my college and then went to America in the 60s and did masters in agricultural economics and economics, concentrated macroeconomics in there, with current techniques being taught at the time, which were input output models and mini programming, and then survey methods. So I carried out surveys in Illinois and south of America, south of North America. And then I came back to the UK in the early 70s and joined IDS, where I was part of a group working in eastern India on looking at modelling and understanding a rural economy in one of the poorest with the highest degrees of inequality possibly in India. Bihar is notorious for its inequality and ownership of assets and incomes. And then I became, and then using surveys and analysis, then I joined CIMMYT, the International Wheat and Maize Group for the Green Revolution, and there was their economist in Delhi during the late parts of the Green Revolution. And then joined the University of East Anglia, and then worked in the end in Nepal on a big World Bank project, and then I retired. So that's my working experience. Just recently, was asked to reflect on my PhD research of 45 years ago. There you go. So this talk is, some of it, not as a result of, but I've had a particular reflective moment, and that's in one of the papers, which I have put in as an appendix to a longer paper on command area development in eastern India. So that's the framework. So let's now, and what I suggest is let me go through, and this framework of analysis has come out of interaction with students over the years and working with colleagues, and it's a framework which encourages debate. So I don't have a conclusion, which is I know where we are now. In fact, I know we have a lot of disjuncture, but a phenomenal amount of ambiguity now in policy debates. And that's just the nature of where we are. So let's go on with the next. Here we go. Do we have a point?
I think that has a point. it doesn't sort of work in the
English. It's the second time you've said that to me. Don't worry, I will use a finger.
Oh, look, look.
Oh, there we go.
Mm-hmm. So
right.
You can take that.
Oh, I see. It's there. Okay. In broad terms, I've got the period of the mid-60s through to the mid-80s. When there, I would suggest there were open policy debates and data collection. We came into a period of the mid-80s through to the mid-2000s of a closing of debates and data collection. It wasn't, it was active, it wasn't passive, it just didn't happen. It was a passive period. And then we have a period now where we're with disruptions and ambiguous policy debates. Let's try going on to the next. And I have to be careful, those are the golden days of when I was a young man and all of that. But in the early days, we had an explicit role for broad-based rural development in overall national development. People didn't say that's the role of rural development, it was right there. We had programs such as IDRP programs, small rural industrialization development, the LGF input output models I've talked a little bit about. The emphasis of work was on field work by agricultural and social scientists and interdisciplinary research by social working with other disciplines. So interdisciplinary in those days meant you had a PhD in your discipline and you worked with somebody else who had a PhD or qualifications in their discipline. It wasn't generous. It was very much different, strong disciplines or people worked. So in the CG system, if we look in this period of during the 70s, we had in the consultative grant, we had Erie with a fully fledged, lots of PhDs in ag engineering, in economics, in a number of different subjects. SIP, the Potato Institute, again had PhDs in anthropology. In CIMIT, you have four or five PhDs and ag econ working with plant breeders on the whole. So it was a period, and all of the work of the mainstream was field work, either doing surveys or doing on-farm work in farmers' fields. That was the whole policy, and it was funded majorly, massively. Then there are open debates and in disciplinary based. So we had in major economists, agricultural economics, one had articles like, and I haven't quoted them here, of the efficiencies of small and large farms in India, where you, but all of that would be based upon empirical field. Choice of technique and technologies was at the center of many of the national debates, whether it's technology as regards tractors or pesticides or fertilizer, you know. Policies debates on the degree of national ownership of the large companies was right out there. Major concern with agrarian structure. In those days, in the 60s and 70s, institutional reform was the degree of land, distributive land reform was a major issue on the agenda. And I come from looking at land reform in southern Italy as an undergraduate. Taiwan had a major distributive land reform. South Korea had a major land distributive. The Punjab and the Haryana in India was one of the few places in India where it had been settled by small lands. So it was an implicit distributive land reform. A major concern in those days was small and medium-sized industries. Finally, the conventional teaching of macroeconomics concerning analysis of policies taking into account market prices or economic prices or social prices, because depending on what values you give to different outcomes, or different income inputs into a policy discussion, you come up with different pros and cons about whether it's a good idea or a bad idea, whether you're looking at it as a national government with concerns of poverty, or you're looking at it as a private company making profits. And those are incredibly elementary, conventional macroeconomic concepts, which we were using in those days. Go to the next slide. This is my convention. For those who don't know about input-output analysis, you divide an economy, whether it's a village or a region or a district or a national economy, into different sectors. So the agricultural sector, the industrial sector, or the service sector, or a trade sector, and you can, oh goodness, I shouldn't have touched it. How do we get rid of that without losing everything?
If you go back with your
yeah.
Uh-huh.
Okay, there we go. And you've got another sector here, and you've got a matrix of looking at the flows of goods and services going from agriculture into agriculture would be there. This would represent industry going into agriculture. This would be goods and products going into industry, going into services. You add all of this up and you come to the total national project, national level for a village. So what is, and you can have trade in here, you can break down industry into an energy industry, energy sources, water sources, and how they go into agriculture. And these are linkages between sectors. So it's a systems approach, but using economics. And you have to come up with valuation and say how you put values on these things. It looks at the flows of goods and services between sectors, composition of final demand, what's the kind of demand. Table can explore positive and negative externalities and changes in one sector on other sectors. The multiplier effects of changes in one part of the economy on other parts of the economy. The effects of the framework can be used for village, for a region, for a. And why I mention this is that in the 60s, these frameworks were drawn up for Pakistan, for India. I, as a macroeconomist, was using these frameworks in work I was doing in India. They were done for villages to get a feel of what the overall economy is, or whatever the region you were looking at. Then we came into a period, I would suggest, mid-80s to the mid-2005 of closing of debates. And that's illustrated by closing of rural engineering departments in the international centres and other places such as Sussex College in the UK and others. I'm concentrating on rural engineering and mechanisation because my argument is that this is one of the elephants in the room, which is just coming into everybody else's debates through the back door, and hasn't, so please forgive this anyway. Closing of data collection on the mechanization programs in FAO. It's now rural mechanization of any description is just a minor department. Reduction of field research by economists and other social scientists with rural mechanization changes. Increased reliance on census data, national sample surveys, big data sets, etc. were often too aggregate, out of date, or did not collect data relevant to understanding rapidly changing patterns of rural mechanization. Separation of different areas of rural engineering, water from rivers, road transport, processing, all of those got separated out. as sub-disciplines. Agriculture and other rural management, left out of agriculture and rural development projects and programs. That's a reality. I'm not creating this. Then we come into now, the mid 2005, 2006 to now. We've now got, and this is just a list of various things going on, energy policy and nexus. People, parts of nexus literature, looking at the relationship between food, water, and energy. And I said, well, that's interesting. That sounds like some input output issues are looking at. What's input output? And I say to myself, I'm not sure where to start here. Because if the people interested in those issues haven't found their way back into the literature, which has looked at this since the mid-60s, there are problems. Because whatever they are discovering as new relationships, you'll find that there's a whole literature about the problems. Not that we've solved the problems, but the issue of the relationship between water, food, and energy is absolutely not new. And so that's an example. The CGIAR system had its CR programs, which were based on an innovation systems approach, and they were all set up about 5 or 6 years ago. Some of them have been getting on, and they're again raising issues which are more fundamental of how to follow up innovation systems approach in doing research. Green revolution in Africa. I tear my hair up because the Punjab Green Revolution is nothing like the Nepal change of agrarian change, nothing like what's going on in Thailand, nothing like what's going on there. But people roll out that there's a thing called the Green Revolution. And don't add on that it's a massively energy subsidized system. And if that's the number one issue of today, as I would argue it is, energy, then you've got people ambiguously kind of saying, oh, the Great Revolution is something we should look at and honour and whatever, forgetting to say, and it's an example of agrarian change of phenomenal wastage of energy. So ambiguity, almost in the same sentence, or in two sentences running together. Anyway, there's a list here, and you can cast your and you'll see various things in it, of which I've been involved in various ways. And I don't want to dwell on this because I want to get on to now looking in particular at an area that I've been working at, and on the spread of smaller engines and marketing engine services in Asian countries. And the reason for my concentration is this is the smaller engines, anything up to, shall we say, 20 horsepower, have made incredible significant changes in agrarian change in rural areas of Asia. It continues to spread rapidly. The role of small-scale rural mechanism and rural industries has been neglected in the recent academic literature and policy debates. And now some observations on these things. Here I'd like to just point out, here's a table, these are all estimates, the life's about estimates. And if you compare Bangladesh, India, and Nepal, as regards, say, something like tractors, if you break them down into four-wheel tractors and two-wheel tractors, you'll find that the total horsepower generated by those two sources in Bangladesh, 53% of the horsepower for the inter-irrigation comes from two-wheel tractors. There are hardly any four-wheel tractors at all in Bangladesh, yet the whole of over 90% of tillage in Bangladesh is done by mechanical means. So that's mainly two-wheel tractors and mini-tills. Not a four-wheel tractor would be seen. You go down to pumping of water, you've got 42% in Bangladesh is done by diesel, a little bit by electricity, and that makes up the total for these kind of mechanical units into energy. That's for Bangladesh. We look at India, and you've got a radically, radically different position of where two-wheel tractors, because the government has never promoted them, make up a tiny percentage of the mechanical horsepower for tillage. Most of them are four-wheel tractors. As regards irrigation, you've got here electric supplied only 1%. Here in India, a preoccupation with electric engines for pumping water. So, and if we look at Nepal, you've got a mixture of other things going on. So, this brings out the extraordinary diversity in mechanical power being used for irrigation, tractor use in those two countries. The whole, they're more, and to bring it out even more dramatically, there are more small two-wheel tractors in Bangladesh, a tiny country, than the whole of the Indian subcontinent. And as a policy analyst who's interested in agrarian change and rural development, I ask the question, you can't tell me that the whole of the Indian subcontinent, there's not a need for smaller two-wheel tractors in many different geographic locations. If you've got in Bangladesh, the whole rural economy is run on this issue. But these kind of macro data in this comparative way throw those questions up. Okay, the next slide. Another observation is the phenomenal diversity of history of mechanization in different Asian countries, going back to the 60s here. You've got India with its own, building up its own industries. You've got Sri Lanka having its own tractors and then linking, importing Chinese. Chinese, you will see here that China has in recent years become the engineering source of good enough, cost-effective engineering for rural areas of Asia. That's the reality of what the data is telling us. Next one. Second of the, in Asia, long history, this is the long history. If these are what, for us who work in rural areas, this would be a local engineering shop, as you can see. Chaos, but that's the nature of engineering workshops in rural areas. Next one. Diversity of equipment in use in the same geographic area. This is a picture of a small, where a tractor engine has been mounted on a small combine harvester. Within about half a mile, somebody's using a smaller harvest device, and within the same area there were people using hand cutting methods. So even with a given location, multiple kinds of technology alongside, because of the different resource situations of the different rural entrepreneurs and farmers in those areas. So anybody who kind of gets into broad figures of promoting the this technique or this technique. We still have it. It's still very much. Anyway, this is another one. Here you've got a mini tiller chugging away here. Here we've got somebody still using bullets. And here somebody still using a hand method. That's actually untrue. That's what he wanted the slide to say. But in fact, that's what he uses to drive his bullets. But never mind. These militers, average life for military about 3 years, total payback on them in this, that, in the poor environment, is 1.5, 2 years. Bangladesh, with two-wheel tractors, people don't change the oil because they, all the standards are, oh, you've got to change the oil because it's going to last for 10 years and we've done our investment. Well, why do I bother to change the oil? Because I can get a new engine for half, for a fraction of the price than changing the oil every year. But that kind of throws an engineer into a complete twist because it's lowering standards, not looking after your equipment. Engineers and are any of them engineers? That's a pity because it's better to have. It's a question about whether having them in the tent or outside of the tent. Anyway, same engines provide power for multiple different purposes. Pumping, renewing, transport, you name it. Small this is from Bangladesh, just to show how not only the phenomenal numbers, but Bangladesh now is a highly mechanized rural industrial society. Still doesn't mind talking to a USA consultant 5 years ago and saying, oh, this is a country which is still primitive, small, backward farms. So that's again a reality of extraordinary what is in front of you if you get the data out. Spread of two-wheel tractors in Thailand over the last few years, you hear from 1990, and you'll see just this. Water management, informal R&D, all this lay flat pipe and this local managing the water is incredibly effective, and it comes from the plastic industry, it can come from research. So this informal R&D as regards technology, one of the most important developments in Asia has been this use of plastic. As far as my investigations go, has come out of informally jumping from one sector to another, and still hasn't written about it. Okay, let's go on. Informal R&D, that's the same. Various examples. Some rural mechanisation spread very rapidly. In Nepal, for the last 5 years, and virtually 0 to 15,000 as regards miniton. That's over 5 years, due to economic circumstances. That's recent spread of a battery powered 3 meters in Bangladesh is 50,000 now, in Nepal 15,000 within 6 years. The issue is rapid change. Smaller combines from China spread rapidly in Sri Lanka from hundreds to 12,000. This is part of ongoing research. Observing hotspots and corridors. So there are often hotspots, clusters, corridors. That's the nature of the spread of rural engineering. Markets empowered services are really not present. There's a whole lot of the literature now on custom services in rural areas, or value added chains and customs. And you say, excuse me, and there's sort of an onus that this is new knowledge, new insight, new projects. In Asia, where I lived, there's never a situation where you don't have markets in services. And the issue is, how is it any of the current, quote, new academic research in this seems to be unaware of this reality, which has been well documented and on the ground? That's one of the reasons I'm here. Mm-hmm. Observation markets, comments or questions. The literature goes back to the 60s and 70s. Land consolidation, levelling, all being necessary for large-scale farming. The evidence of Bangladesh is that you've got declining holding size, increased productivity in rural areas, with the spread of smaller equipment than a market. So that goes against that assertion by engineers and many others that you need consolidation of land in order to get the so-called economies of scale. And one asks, where do these assertions come from and not be questioned? And Reagan article talked about the smallholders of assistant in Thailand and other Asian. Why are they persistent? Again, if one does the analysis, you find that it's because you've got these long existed markets and services. Okay, this is about privileged access to markets. How are markets work? Are they fair? Are they fair? How are prices set? These are issues which are newer issues in the coming up there. Perhaps the spread of smaller scale machines so that it is leading to more efficient and equitable rural national economic development. That's quite a strong statement we've been making for this presentation, saying the academy has not been looking at what's been going on the ground for the last 10 or 15, 20 years. Effects of government policy, Gumpol and Donor Project have played a central role in the spread of different patterns of rural mechanization. the notorious Indian Green Revolution and massive subsidization of equipment, energy in the form of fertilizer, pumping of water, free electricity for pumping of water, has been a whole example, notorious example, of how you've had agriculture production increases, but at major costs, massive costs. And to understand the spread of engines and markets, it's important to invest in the actual role of government and others pay, rather than the theoretical role.
Mm.
It comes back to a question of monitoring and evaluation, government programs or a donor program. And one finds that simple part of project cycle management, policy cycle management, the politics of that is what we need to be looking at, not the kind of simplistic mechanical view that it happens, or it should happen. You know, when I find it happen, I'm amazed. But when it appears, governments are monitoring and changing their programs. Or when donors seem to be going ahead based upon experience of programs. What's old in all of this? What's old is national aid agencies promoting their own national agendas. That's old, isn't it? Multinationals promoting their products. That's old. International R&D organizations promoting their interests. CG, FAO, ITDG, you know. Recognition of the importance of interdisciplinary research and policy. That is old. That was 60s and 70s. And we sort of didn't. Analysis of custom service, it's old, we were doing it. So when I see it coming up as a new issue, I'm puzzled. What's new? Well, some of what's new is that we've had rising inequality in wealth and incomes. There's nobody who disputes that data. And in rural areas, the move towards more consolidation of ownership of land ownership of land, and I would argue the ownership of capital goods. The ownership of capital goods, I track all of the mechanical stuff, which is an addition to the land, is becoming, the ownership of that is becoming, in many situations, more important than the actual ownership of land. And we've sort of known that for years. But it's kind of hideous in the face though, with people talking about land grab by corporate companies, and we're talking about value-added chains of purchase of fruits in the UK from the, but looking, you know, behind all of this is rural engineering. What's new for me, and it's a challenge to you folks, is a decrease of interest in sustained fieldwork in rural areas by academics. My period of time was characterized by not only fieldwork for your PhD, but actually once you got your PhD, carrying on in the field. And that's why that period is very distinctive. Centrality of energy policy to agriculture and rural economic development, that's in various ways now being recognized, but you've got this ambiguity about not kind of recognizing it at one level, but not doing anything about it at another. Brexit, common agricultural policy, is possibly focusing the mind in the UK on the absurdity of some of the dimensions of the common agricultural policy in ways which the academy in the UK seemed to be quite happy in not challenging significantly common agricultural policy, which is what India, you know, what we've then been advocating in many developing countries. This privileged position of landowners in rural areas. And it's Brexit, which is a disruptive moment, political destructive moment, which has got more thinking and open discussion about the rural countryside and the use of rural areas in the UK than has happened for the whole of that period when the debates were closed. So size and range of techniques is now massive. And I don't know how to handle that. So it's not nice. I just know that in the early days we had big tractors, middle tractors, and little, and what we call production function. Now, and so the 1.2 trillion. Now, it's the complete range, which is a challenge. Let's see, size of institutions are so big. Rural capital goods are more important than land. Often this has been so in the past. Anybody who looks at the history of the sugar industries, indigo industries, bread industries, milk, rocket, spices, you suddenly start saying, excuse me, we've sort of, historians have been here before. So what's this all about? A new globalization of the food industries. It's certainly, so maybe that should be going in. It's not new. What's new is that somehow or other we're being made aware of these things by the television shows or this or this or this. But then how and if that's impinging then on current policy is ambiguous. Okay, questions? Final massive international migrant remittance off, and the people are off from rural areas. That's new. That wasn't part of our thinkings in this. Some of it should have been. Migrant economies in South Asia were were enormous even then, but we somehow or other didn't look at them very much or take on their significance. Some of their significance are now being borne out by what we're seeing in Bangladesh, in Burma, in Vietnam, all those of, you know, the traditions of migrants and legitimacy in different, under different governments. And now, there, they were there in my earlier days, we didn't look at them much. Ways forward. For me, revive interest in broad-based rural economic development. It was there in the early days. I don't see how some of the global and poverty issues of today can be addressed unless we start taking seriously again. Recognize the importance of the contemporary geographic, economic, and political context. Revival of the LGF macroeconomic policy. This came out of my reflection back to 45 years ago. I had moved out of all that conflict for the last 20, 30 years. Going back, I find there are people now doing it. We've still got hydrologists doing models of the whole of the river basin for this cozy area, really big river, massive from the Himalayas into India. And we've got all these hydrological models, we've got flow models, better measuring of the drops of water in different parts flowing down. And then I ask, well, yeah, I respect that, but where are your models, which are also alongside those, looking at the contemporary economy of what, how policy of regards to flows of water or holding in will have on local economies? Not done. And the data isn't even being collected about what is the economies now in these areas. So we've got, it's not because we don't have the framework, and then these models, Stephen, are too complicated. We were managing those models in the 1960s and early 70s, when the University of Sussex had 17K storage space. So the argument that you can't do them because they're all too complex. The complexity depends on what you decide on how complex to make your models, not on inherently saying, you can always say, look, the computers can't manage the complexity. And anybody who said complexity is a new issue. So if you go to kind of lecture 101 in any discipline, and it's all about how this our discipline manages and makes assumptions about complexity. So complexity as a new subject is means somebody hasn't been to an elementary course in any discipline. I was surprised to find that I have come to saying not only are in these input-output models, but also the data which you need, because in order to construct a model for a region or an economy of the different sizes of industry, you need to do the surveys, and that takes field work. And if you've closed down the field work, which collects that base data, or the people who then want to handle it in this way for these kind of rural development purposes, then you've got a real problem. Revival of field studies in rural areas by economists and engineers. For example, cost effective studies of rural entrepreneurs who provide customer service. And I'm just saying, you know, the example of the kind of things I have in mind was done in 1971. Support pragmatic contemporary field-based rural energy accounting and others, 75. Promotion of professional collaboration between economics, engineering, and teaching. I now reflect that it's the engineers, which us economists and social scientists should be working with as regards collaborative work over the years, rather than with the plant breeders or different areas of social science working together. Okay, I think we've just concluding one. History matters. The history and contemporary economy helped explain why and how technical an institution in those came about. The challenge for today's academy is to recognize this and show what theory and evidence to use in policy context. But the biggest political issue is whether equitable, broad-based rural economic development is a major goal of public policy and policy practice. And that's come right the way back. And that's a topic I've been professionally interested in, you know, much of my professional life. And on reflection, keep on coming back to that. Yeah, that's all I have to say. Nine friends I work with in Simit, in Bangladesh, in Nepal, colleagues in Sri Lanka, good friends, and these are just background materials of where we did one with Scotland and why history matters in engineering. This one was one where I reflected back on 35 years ago. This is the paradox of learning in project science. This 19 I brought along, and it, 1991, but I started this in the early 80s, just saying there are lots of different types of analysis which can be done, and people have to make choices. Shelley Feldman, who's written more in your subject, agricultural debates and practice, and then just some recent work on Bangladesh, like looking at rural change in Bangladesh. All right, thank you very much. That's all I have to say.